Hi students, welcome to Section in Lectures and welcome to Material Testing Lab, Strength of Materials Lab, a new playlist. In today's class, we shall see the torsion test on a mild shell shaft, wherein we will try to find out the modulus of rigidity by conducting the experiment on this torsion testing machine. In the previous class, we have seen the spring test, wherein we obtained the stiffness as well as modulus of rigidity using the AMSA's universal testing machine. I hope you enjoyed this discussion there. Then don't forget to click like, share and subscribe to our YouTube channel, right? Now let us see the brief profile of the speaker. I, Dr. D. Rupeshwaran, obtained my BTEC in civil engineering from Nagarjuna University in 1994 and MTEC section engineering from JNTU Hyderabad in 2000 and PhD section engineering from JNTU Hyderabad in 2009. At present, I am working as Professor of Department of Civil Engineering, University College of Engineering, Osman University, Hyderabad, Telangana State. Right? I have an experience of 27 years, of which 7 years is in industry and 20 years is in teaching and research at graduate and postgraduate levels. My research areas include reinforced cement concrete design, steel structural design, structural analysis, fundamental analysis, earthquake engineering, bridge engineering, structural optimization. I've published 45 research papers in international as well as national journals and conferences, organized 3 international conferences and 11 national conferences and workshops, attended 43 workshops, visited 2 countries and delivered 13 guest lectures and edited 3 books, and supervising 14 PhD scholars and supervising 30 MA theses. Presently, I'm actively involved in various consultancy works that are offered by the department and completed over 770 design proof checks and 150 designs of the RCC, steel, composite, low rise, high rise, multi story buildings, and as well as road and rail bridges. Right? Now, let us move to the discussion, student. We'll see the experiment in 3 parts. Right? The first part is that we'll try to see what is the aim, apparatus, theory, as well as the description of the machine, as well as the processor in the first part. In the second part, we'll try to conduct the experiment lively. And the third part, we'll do the calculations. One, table calculation. Second one is graphical calculation, as well as the inference calculations. And we'll draw the write the results also, right? Now let us see the very first part, student. This is the torsion test, wherein what is the aim, right? The aim is to determine the modulus of rigidity of the given steel shaft, right? Wherein, what is the apparatus? Is Olson's torsion testing machine, right? Even a microscope to read up to 0.01, second one, and as well as vernier calipers to measure the diameters of the shaft, as well as a scale to measure the distances. So these are the different apparatus that will be given to you. And the theory is like this: when two equal forces which are parallel and opposite but do not lie in the same plane as the longitudinal axis of the body are applied, a couple is a setup. This coupling produces a twisting action about the longitudinal axis of the section, and this condition is known as the torsion, right? Now this is how it will be leading to a torsion. I'm just now showing this. This member is subjected to a torsion, right? Now like this, right? Therefore, the practical application of the torsion test is merely a reproduction of the actual service conditions. Power transmission shafts as well as the twisted drills are tested for torsion to determine the rigidity modulus for calculating the shear stress, right? Then, however, as per this simple torsion formula, which is subjected to cube torsion or simple torsion formula, we know that T by J is equal to tau by R is equal to CT tile, R tau is equal to Fs, where the modulus of rigidity from this first part, T by J is equal to CT tau by L, if I take, then I will get a modulus of rigidity C is equal to TL by J theta, where T is the torsion or torque in kg centimeter and L is the length of the specimen in centimeters and J is the polar moment of inertia, which is calculated by pi d to power 4 by 32 for the solid shafts, and theta is the angle of the twist in radians, which is measured in terms of the length of the arc and radian, means theta is equal to S by H, right? And S is the distance between the pencil marks from the first mark measured in centimeters, and H is the distance of the sector from the axis of the shaft in centimeters. Therefore, the modulus of rigidity now is equal to C is equal to TL H divided by JS kg per centimeter square, right? This is the Olson's torsion testing machine. This is a schematic, student, right? This is how the specimen where it will be put, and this at the other end we have the stationary chuck, whereas where the motor is there, we do have the
rotating chuck. Please make a note. And this is the gear handle, right? This is a sector where we'll be pasting the white piece of paper for marking the deformations. And this is what the line diagram of this after displaced positions, right? G to G prime, G to G prime, and B to B prime, right? Then description of this machine, right? The torsion testing machine essentially consists of the two chucks. Now let me show the these two chucks, student, right? This is the right, these two chucks, right? These two chucks, wherein this is the stationary chuck and this is the rotating chuck. Because here I do have the entire arrangement, therefore this is what called the rotating chuck. This is the stationary chuck, right? And this is the sector where the white piece of paper is marked with pasted, and this is the needle for measurement of the distance over this much of distance. What is that distance traveled along this sector, right? That is all. And this is the balancing beam where this jockey will be put shifted to the different locations, to the different locations, right? Now let us see this. Then one is stationary and the other is rotating. The specimen is fixed rigidly at one end and the other end is twisted, right? The stationary chuck is connected to the lever F1B at A. When torque is applied to the specimen, the chuck tends to rotate in the direction shown by the arrow. This will rotate the beam CD to C prime D prime about the fulcrum F2 and EG to E prime G prime about the fulcrum F3. Now this one, this schematic, student, what we are discussing, right, in the line diagram, right? And now the jockey J can be moved to balance the beam, right? The beam EG has graduations, right? The straining of the shaft is done by induction motor or even manually also, right, which has switch gear with 4 speed each in forward and backward directions, right? Now let me show that gear, right? This is how, right, these are 1, 2, 3, 4 gears in forward as well as backward direction, right? During loading will be generally during increasing load will, or even you can manually rotate this wheel also. This is what called the straining wheel, right? Therefore even during increasing load, I need to rotate this in clockwise direction. During decreasing load, unloading, I need to rotate this by in the anti-clockwise direction, right? So as to balance this beam, right? Now, let us see the processor at a quicker pace, student, right? Then the processor is like this, right? The measure the outer and inner diameters of the shaft, right? This is the shaft, student, right? This is the shaft, right? However, I do have the only outer diameter because I'm using the solid shaft, right? Whereas these are the other shafts, right, of different diameters, even I've shown during the experimentation. And these are the jackies. These are the jackies, whereas we are now putting a jackie of 11,600 pound inch, whereas this is 1,16,000 pound inch, whereas this is 2,32,000 pound inch jackie, which can be put over this balancing beam, right? Now or like this, right? Therefore this is a 11,600 jackies put here over this balancing beam, right? Whereas these are the other jackies and these are the other shafts of different diameters. If you are solid, if you are hollow, right? Like this. Now once we measure the outer and inner diameter of the specimen, then adjust the pointer and the sector mounted on the specimen in such a way that the pointer is just near the surface of the section, right? And next, correct the machine to read zero with no torque, then paste a paper over the sector and mark position of the pointer on the paper by a pointed pencil, like this, right? Here, right? Over this, right? Over this sector. It is a pointer you mark using a pencil, or here, let me show, right, in another view, right? That is how, once I do that. Now keep the jockey at 1000 pound inch, or there is approximately 1950 kg centimeter torque, and start the motor to strain the specimen till the balancing beam attains the horizontal position, right? Once I shift this to jockey from 0 to 1000 pound inch, 1000 pound inch strength, obviously this balancing beam will down move downward. Therefore, now rotating this strain wheel in the increasing direction, in the clockwise direction, then this balancing arm can be beam can be brought to the horizontal position. Therefore, that is how the experiment will be conducted, right? And due to the torque, the pointer will come to some extent to now keep the jockey at 1000 pound inch torque and start the motor to strain the specimen till the balancing beam attains the horizontal position, during which the pointer will come to some extent relative to the sector. Therefore, mark another point on the point on the pointer paper corresponding to the second position of the points, right, and proceed like this the experiment for successive torques in the increasing or loading as well as the decreasing or unloading positions also, and mark the positions of the pointer for different values, right. Now remove the paper carrying the these marks, right, one during loading as well as second one is during unloading, right, and paste another paper over that sector for unloading now, right. Again mark the positions of the pointer while decreasing the torque in the same steps, and take out the again from the sector. You just remove this from the sector, and with the help of the traveling microscope measure the distance between the pencil marks relative to the first mark and record them, right. Record them, right. That is all the process should. Now let us connect the experiment, right, before we do the calibrations, right.
Okay, student, welcome to the metal testing lab. In this class we shall see the torsion testing machine and torsion test on a given shaft, right. This is how the different shafts will be given to you, right. Either they may be the solid shafts or they may be the hollow shafts, right, like this, right, of different diameters. Now you can see that we will have almost 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, right, 8 as well as what, 9 shafts are there. If you are hollow, if you are solid, now you can see they are of varying diameters, right. Even we will have for applying the torques, the jockeys are there, right. Here I am showing a jockey of using which I can apply maximum 11,600. You see that 11,600. Whereas this is in FPS units, even that 11,600 is seen here. Please see here, right? 11,600. What is there here is IN, LPS is inch pounds. These units are in inch pounds, right? Pound inch, right? Therefore, using this jacket, maximum I can apply 11,600 pound inch, whereas using this jacket now you can see 1 lakh 16,000 pound inch, that much of torque can be applied. Whereas now you can see here that this is using this jacket, if I put this there, then I can apply 2 lakh 32,000 pound inch torque. 2,32,000, even here all the three are seen, right? 11,600, 1,16,000 and 2,32,000 pound inch torque. These are the jackies. Of which for our test we will be using only 11,600 jackie. 11,600 jackie. Okay, student. Once we have seen the shafts of the different diameters and the jockey side, in our experiment we will be using 11,600 torque jockey, right, using which at maximum I can apply 11,600, that you can see here, right, 11,600 only, right, that is now put at zero torque, right, whereas this is the balancing beam, student, this is a torsion testing machine, right. Now this is called the balancing beam. On this balancing beam, this jockey is put, which is indicating 11,600, means if I use the jockey maximum I can apply 11,600 pound inch torque. If I put that here, right, then I can apply maximum of 11,600. Even other marks we can see, right, 10 is seen, means followed by 2 zeros, means if I put this at 10, we can apply 1000 pound inch. Like that, if I put it at 20 is seen, right, then 2000 pound inch can be applied. Like that, if I just mean to the other end, we can see 116 followed by two zeros means 11,600 pound inch maximum torque can be applied using this jacket by shifting this on the balancing beam. This is called the balancing beam, right? And also, this will also be working on the principle of the hydraulic fluid pressure principle, right? As I explained in tension test, right? Wherein, now let us see first what we will be doing is that we already fixed a shaft, a solid shaft in this torsion testing machine, right? Between these two grips, chucks, right? Wherein I have to have on one side one chuck which is fixed, whereas on the other hand another chuck is there, right? That will be rotating. One is fixed, one is rotating, right? Because of that, I can get the rotations, or that is called the twist. Twist can be measured, right? Now let us see, those twists can be measured by the pencil marks. Now let us come to the observation part. First, using the vernier calipers, I will be measuring the diameter of this shaft at three different locations, right? At three different locations, like this, right? Therefore, now I will take the diameter, now I will fix, right? And I'll measure the diameter, right? Measure the diameter at three different locations, main scale reading, vernier coincidence, and the total reading, right? At one, two, three locations. Therefore, that is how the first observation is taken. And before we start the experiment, right, already the jack is put at zero torque, and we see that this balancing arm is perfectly in horizontal position. It is not at all strained, no torque is applied, no twist has happened for this specimen, right? At that point of time, you please see that there is a pointer, right, where that indicates what is the twist that has happened, right? Therefore, due to the application of the torque, right? Therefore, due to have a sector, this is called a sector student, right? Therefore, over this sector, I'll be pasting a piece of paper. Therefore, now you can see that a piece of paper is already pasted here, right? And a needle is showing a point, right? Against which now I'll mark a pencil mark, right? I'm just marking that, right? Now you can see that I'm just marking a pencil mark, right, over the white paper which is pasted on the sector, right? Therefore, now we are ready with the first observation, right? With torque of zero, right, on the sector, on this white piece of paper, I have marked zero, right? During increase, I am going to increase the load. This is during increasing load, I, right? And then I want to apply the torque, therefore, for which what I will do is either I can manually lift and put to required torque like this, right? Therefore, this is one procedure, right? Now you can see that I have just lifted this jockey and put at 10. 10 means followed by 2 zeros means, 10 followed by 2 zeros means 1000 pound inch. Because of it, now you can see that the balancing beam has gone downwards, right? Therefore, now in order to transfer this torque, still the torque is not transferred to the specimen, right? Therefore, now in order to apply that torque, now I'll rotate the wheel. Hey student, once I have applied the torque of 1000 pound inch, then the balancing beam has gone downward in the clockwise direction. Therefore, I'll use manual operation. Even there are the two ways, right? Either I can use manually during increasing load, I can rotate this strain wheel in the clockwise direction during increasing load, during increasing load, right? Whereas during decreasing load, I'll rotate this strain wheel in the anti-clockwise direction, right? This is one position. Or alternatively, even I can use this electric motor, right? Which will be using the hydraulic principle, right? It will exert the hydraulic pressure to bring back the balancing arm to the horizontal position, right? There is so now I'm just operating this manually. Now you can see once I'm operating this balancing arm, coming back to the horizontal position, right? Therefore, that is how once the balancing beam is in horizontal position, right? During this operation only, the torque is applied to the other end of the specimen. Now you can even that cannot be observed with our naked eye because the deformation is so small. The twist is so small. Deformation means twist is so small. Therefore, during which now you can see once the balancing beam is in horizontal position, now the pointer has shifted from initial zero mark to a new position. Therefore, now I'm just marking the next mark, right? Therefore, now what I'll do is, now the first observation is over. Now I'll increase further the torsion torque value to 2000. I'm just putting at 20 followed by 20, 2000, right? Once again, you can see that the balancing arm is going in the downward direction. Therefore, doing the same procedure, right? Using the strain wheel, rotating that in the clockwise direction, I'll bring back this to the horizontal position. Like this, once I bring it back, the balancing arm, balancing beam in the horizontal position, I'll load down the next twist. Next twist on this piece of paper, right? Therefore, that is how the. Now you can see that this is there in the horizontal position. The balancing beam is there in the horizontal position, right? Therefore, once it is there in the horizontal position, now I'll mark third mark, pencil mark, right? Like that, I go on applying the torque, the next value as 3000, right? And 4000, and last one is the number 5000, right? During which, once again, I'll rotate the strain wheel in the clockwise direction to bring back to horizontal position, right? During increasing load. However, now, all the loads will be applied with an elastic limit. Therefore, now during decreasing load, now what I'll do is from 5000 to 4000, I'll go back to 5000 to 4000, right? Before I go back to the 5000 to 4000, what now I'll do is I'll remove this piece of paper, right? I'm there at 5000, shouldn't I? Still, I'm there at 5000 pound inch, right? Therefore, now during increment load, all the observations are noted down. Using this pencil, right? Pencil marks are already noted down. Now I'll remove this piece of paper from the sector, which is already pasted by means of the gum, right? Now I'll remove and I'll paste a new piece of paper on this sector using the gum, right? Therefore, once this is pasted, now I'll note down where the pointer is indicating. That is my first point, right? That is my first point during the decreasing load. This is during decreasing load, right? For I already pasted that pencil. Now I will decrease the load from 5000 to 4000. Right? Therefore, once I have decreased the load from 5000 to 4000, obviously it will, this lever arm will go upward. Previously, we applied the load to increment, during which the balancing arm has gone downward, right? Now I am decreasing the load because of which this arm will go upward. Therefore, once this arm goes upward, now I need to rotate the strain wheel during the decreasing direction in the anti-clockwise direction. Therefore, doing that, this balancing arm will be brought from top to horizontal position because it has already gone in the anti-clockwise direction. Therefore, I am just rotating this strain wheel also in the anti-clockwise direction so that this balancing arm will be brought to the horizontal position, right? Once it is there in the horizontal position and load down, the next pencil mark, right? This is the first pencil mark during the decrement load. We are already at 5000 now, I am there at 4000, right? Likewise, you go on decreasing the load to 3000 and 2000, right? 1000, and lastly, that of the zero load, and repeat the same procedure till you get the zero torque, right? Therefore, for the zero torque also, you just adjust and bring back this balancing arm to the horizontal position, and note down the pencil mark, right? Now, let us see the tabular format. Okay, Shwet, once we are done with all the observations, the next observation is that what is the distance between these two marks within which the twist is measured, right? Therefore, between these two ends, and I am just measuring using the scale, right? The scale. Therefore, I note down this reading between these two ends over which the twist is measured, one observation, right? And the second observation is that what is this height of this sector above this diameter, that also note down, it is approximately 25 cm, right? However, I want this height from the center of this shaft. Therefore, we already know what is the diameter of that shaft. Therefore, you add the radius to this height, so that we get the height from the central axis of the shaft. Once I take those observations, these are the observations what I have just noted down here, right? These are the observations what I have noted, right? The diameter of this shaft specimen, capital D, is equal to 38.03 mm. From which you can calculate the polar load of pressure using this formula, pi d2 power 400 by 32, which is notated by J or Izz, either of the two is true, right? Also, just now we have measured the length of this shaft specimen, and that is 56 cm, I already showed. Now, that is 560 mm, right? And also, just now we have measured the height of the section from the axis of the shaft. Actually, I have not measured from the axis of the shaft, I have measured above the shaft, right? Therefore, that plus half the diameter. Therefore, if I add, that now works out, say 272.15, right? Therefore, these are the three observations we already noted from the experimental setup. Now, even these values we already noted, right? Now, wherein? Okay, sure. Once I take the three observations, diameter, length and height, then what I need to do, that already removed the paper slips over which the twist is measured. Therefore, I am just putting that under this microscopic observation, right? Therefore, wherein I want to measure what is the distance between these observations of that of the pencil marks, right? Therefore, I am using this micrometer, right? Wherein I'll just put now before I start the experimentation, right? Seeing through this eyepiece, right? Once I see through this eyepiece, what I can see is the cross hairs are seen, right? Therefore, making an adjustment, right? Now I'll adjust this paper in such a fashion that the cross hair is matching with the first 0th reading. Yes, I'm just adjusting, just wait, right? Therefore, I'm just adjusting, right? Yes. Once I achieve that, just wait, right? Yes, now it is matching, right? Once I achieve that, what now I'll do is I'll put this weight over this so that there is no movement of this paper. Then at that point of time, you please see that this main scale reading, which is consisting of 0 to 0 to, now you please see that, right? 1 means 10, 20, so on and so forth, 9, 90, 100, right? There are 100 readings are there on this this vernier scale, sorry, vernier scale, 100 readings are there, whereas here the main scale reading is there, right? 0, right? 5, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to 10 to 20, right? Therefore, there is the main scale reading is 0 to 20, whereas here this vernier scale is 100 readings are there, 100 readings are there. Therefore, once I adjust this crosshair matching with the 0th reading, we need to ensure that that main scale reading is indicating the pointer 0, right? As well as here there is a pointer, it should also be indicating the 0 of this vernier scale, right? Therefore, once we ensure this, now what I'll do is that I'll go to the next observation. Therefore, I'm just rotating this in clockwise direction so that I'll reach to the next observation, right? Once the crosshair touches the next, yes, now it is there, right? Now I'll note down what is the observation. Therefore, now those observations are noted on the table. Now I'll come back, right? Therefore, that is how you go on taking by matching with the second to third observation, right? You note down what is the main scale reading and as well as that are the vernier coincidence, right? That is how you go on increasing till last observation is obtained, right? Once you get the last observation, you remove this piece of paper and you put that of the decreasing during the decreasing load, that piece of paper, right? That of the first observation we have started with, that of the last load is equal to 6000 pound inch. Therefore, now I'll put that 6000 pound inch, right, corresponding to that the piece of paper here, and we already stopped with the observation during the increment load, right? I just got for 1000, I got 1.17, for 2000 I got 1.96, for 3000 I got 3.47, for 4000 4.48, for 5000 5.48, for 6000 6.18 from this microscopic arrangement, right? Observations, right? Whereas now I'm starting once again afresh on the unloading or decreasing load. Therefore, I'm repeating this procedure. Therefore, now I do have starting from the zeroth torque where I already matched my crosshairs to the zeroth torque, right? Therefore, now I proceed to the next torque. There I'm getting the reading as 1.33, right? Similarly, for 2000 I'm getting 2.48, for 3000 3.41, for 4000 4.6, and for 5000 it is 5.6 mm, and for 6000 it is 6.94 mm. Once I get these during increasing as well as decreasing or during loading and unloading torque, now I will do the average of these two, 1.17 plus 1.2 is equal to 1.25. Once I get this, using this formula, shear modulus or modulus of rigidity can be obtained using this C is equal to PL H divided by JS, whereas T is the torque applied, right? T and this is the torque applied, right? T and L, it's already known, right? This is the L, which is equal to 560, and H is equal to 272.15. The denominator J you can calculate using that formula in terms of mm to the power 4, and S, this is the average distance between these pencil marks, which is from the first observation is 1.25. For substituting this, now you get the shear modulus or modulus of rigidity as say 0.7622 10 to the power 5 newton per mm square, right? Likewise, you go on doing the calculations for the second, third, fourth, and fifth observations, all the observations, and take the average, right? Report the result as the average result as the modulus of rigidity or shear modulus of the given solid shaft specimen, right? From table calculation. Once again, I'll draw a graph between the torque on the y-axis as well as the distance between the pencil marks, S, in terms of mm on the x-axis, and you draw a best fit curve using the least stress principle. Already explained in the previous experiment, right? Take the different curves and find out the distances d1, d2, d3, so on and so forth. That sum up all those i squares, whichever curve has the minimum value, that is the best fit, satisfying this principle of least squares. Therefore, once you get a best fit curve, you take the slope, right? The slope over large area, not a small area. Don't take over a small area, right? Errors may the calculations over small area, if I do, then errors may happen. Therefore, you take the slope over large area so that errors can be minimized. Therefore, not taking the large over large area ordinate to this abscissa, therefore, what is the slope is equal to t by s. These in terms of pound inch per mm, or even you can convert in terms of kg centimeter per mm or newton mm per mm, right? Once I get this slope, then once again substitute in the above formula, right? As right t, right? Therefore, now you get the shear modulus from the graph as say this t by s is already the slope of this graph. Therefore, now you multiply with LH divided by J in terms of Newton per mm square. Right? That is all. This is the slope. T by S is the slope. Right? Therefore, that is how you get the shear modulus from the graph also. Only one result, because that is itself is representing the entire graph. Right? Therefore, now you write the results. Right? Results are for the given shaft specimen by conducting the torsion test. The rigidity modulus or modulus of rigidity 1 from tabular calculation, you report the result, average result, the shear modulus C is going to maybe some 0.7588 10^5 from those one, and 2 from graphical calculations, the shear modulus is going to maybe some 0.7311 10^5 from those one, right? These are the results, right? Once I write the results, then we also do the inference calculations, assuming the concentration of the steel shaft as 0.25. Now you get what is the Young's modulus given by this formula is equal to 2c to 1 plus mu r mu. Here already c value is known, for substituting it always the Young's modulus in terms of Newton per mm square. Also we know e is equal to 3k to 1 minus 2 nu, whereas in the previous step I got e. Therefore now you substitute e here, therefore only unknown is equal to k, which is the bulk modulus. Therefore you get that k value also. You report them as the inferences, comments, right? Assuming Poisson's ratio is 0.25, one shear modulus is this much, maybe some 0.7955, Young's modulus is equal to some 1.9958 10^5 per mm square, and bulk modulus maybe approximately 0.5233 10^5 per mm square. Right? That is how the inferences are also drawn. These are the comments or inferences now drawn, right? That is how the torsion test experiment student, right? I hope you understood these experiments, right? Okay, we will see the other experiments in the next class. Till then, bye bye, students.
Yeah. Okay, student, right? Once we conduct the experiment, let us see what are the observations and calculations, student. This is the observations and calculations. I've just measured the diameter of the specimen as 38.03 mm and length of the specimen is measured as all as say 57 centimeter or 570 mm and height of the section from the axis of the shaft is equal to 272.15 mm, and the polar moment of inertia J is equal to pi d^4/32 or D is equal to 38.03 ^4, that means pi/32, it works out say 2.05 × 10^5 mm to the power 4. And now let us do the calculation for the first observation, right? Now let us see the observations. These are my observation, student. I am applying initially zero torque was there, therefore zero mark between the pencil mark, because that is the first point. Therefore now applying 1000 pound inch, whereas that is in terms of kg centimeter. If I convert it, it is approximately 1152 kg centimeter. However, I have observed during increasing load The distance between the pencil marks as 1.17. I have increased to the second load 2000 pound inch, which is approximately 2304 kg centimeter, for which I have this distance between the pencil marks as 1.96. Like that, for the 3000 pound inch, this is 3.47. For 4000 pound inch, this is 4.48. This is 5000 pound inch, 5.58, and 6000 pound inch are approximately 6913 kg centimeter. It is 6.18. Whereas during decrement also, I am just repeating that for I got for 1000 1.33, for 2000 pound inch 2.48, for 3000 I got 3.41 centimeter. These are in terms of mm, and for 4000 4.46, and 5000 5.60, and whereas for 6000 or 6912 kg centimeter, I got 6.94 as the distance between the pencil marks during the decreasing load or unloading. Therefore, now I'll take the average of these two. Now let me do the sample calculation. Let me move to the sample calculation. Therefore, I am initiating the sample calculation, right? Therefore, this is the sample calculation for 1000 pound inch, which is approximately 1152 kg centimeter, whereas the distance just now we have seen between the pencil marks during the increasing, it is equal to 1.17 mm, whereas during decreasing, it is 1.33. Therefore, the average distance between these pencil marks is equal to 1.33 plus 1.17 divided by 2, which is equal to 1.25 mm. Therefore, the shear modulus or modulus of rigidity is equal to TLJ divided by JS. However, T is equal to 1152 approximately kg centimeter, and that if I want to convert in terms of Newton, multiply 9.81. with 9.81, and that length is equal to 570 mm, and height of this shaft above it, this longitudinal axis of the shaft is equal to 272.15 divided by J is equal to 2.052 10 to the power 5, and S is equal to 1.25 mm. Therefore, substituting with, now I'll get this C value, modulus of rigidity or shear modulus, is equal to 0.7622 10 to the power 5 newton per mm square. Therefore, that is how I just got this 0.7622. Therefore, similarly, you do the calculations for the other observations. Now I am getting 0.7854, 0.7654, 0.7681, 0.7861, and 0.7974 10 to the power 5 newton per mm square. Right. These calculations are done. Therefore, once I do that, now what I'll do is I'll take the average of all these readings, as now it is obtained as average of the 6 readings. Now I'm getting that as 0.7674 10 to the power 5 newton per mm square. Right, now I'm done with the table calculations. Today, now I'll do the graphical calculations. Right, now I'm taking the torque on the y-axis in terms of kg centimeter, or even you can draw to pound inch also, that would be better, because 1000 pound inch, 2000 pound inch, that will be better rather than that of this kg centimeter. But here I have drawn on kg centimeter on y axis as a torque, and the distance between the pencil marks, S, is in terms of mm, right? Therefore, one unit is equal to 0.5 mm on the x axis, whereas on the y axis, one unit is equal to 500 kg centimeter. Kg centimeter, these are my scales, right? However, I have just marked all these, right, 1152 against this distance between the marks, pencil marks as 1.25, like that, the second, third, fourth, fifth parts. Now I am drawing a best fit curve. Therefore, after drawing the best fit curve, I am taking the ordinate, this ordinate to this abscissa. Therefore, that now works out, say, a value of now measuring from graphical calculation, what is the slope? That is equal to T by S is equal to, now I'm getting that result as, say, 1015.1 kg centimeter per mm, or say it is approximately 10,151 kg mm per mm. Therefore, once I fix the slope of this graph, now the rigidity modulus is nothing but the slope multiplied by LH divided by J. Therefore, 10,151 multiplied by length is equal to 570 multiplied by this H is equal to 272.15. To convert in terms of Newton mm, Newton from kg, I am multiplying with 9.81 divided by 2.05 to the power 5, right? That works out, say, 0.7667 7.4 10 to power 5 newton per mm square from graphical calculation. Now we'll do the inference calculations. Assume the Poisson's ratio for the steel shaft and multi-steel shaft mu is equal to 1 by m is equal to 0.25. Therefore, we know this relationship between the modulus of rigidity and the shear modulus size is equal to 2c into 1 plus mu. Therefore, I already know what is the c value, which is 0.7674. From the table calculation, therefore, upon substitution, I'll get Young's modulus is equal to 1.9087 10 to the power 5 newton per mm square, right? Also, we know this relationship between the Young's modulus and the bulk modulus as E is equal to 3k into 1 minus 2 nu. However, in the previous step, I got E is equal to 1.9087, right? 9087. Therefore, substituting with, now I'll get the bulk modulus is equal to, say, approximately 0.512 10 to the power 5 newton per mm square. Mm square also, right? And similarly, you can get these results from the graph also. Therefore, from graphical calculations, E is equal to 1.918 10 to the power 5 newton per mm square, as well as from graphical calculations, the bulk modulus is equal to 0.511 10 to the power 5 newton per mm square. However, these are the precautions that the straining should be affected in slow gear only, right? Now, these are the final results, student. Therefore, for the given steel shaft specimen, the modulus of the rigidity 1 from the table calculations is equal to C is equal to 0.7674 10 to the power 5 newton per square, and from the graphical calculations is equal to 0.7674 10 to the power 5 newton per square. Almost both are same results, right? And these are the inferences and comments. Assuming Poisson's ratio as of the given shaft as 0.251, modulus of rigidity is already calculated from the table. If at all that is at value, then what is the modulus of elasticity of the given specimen? That is calculated as E is equal to 1.9087 10 to the power 5 newton per square, and also it can be inferred that the bulk modulus of the given shaft specimen K is equal to 0.512 10 to the power 5 newton per mm square. That is how the experiment on the torsion test, student, right? I hope you enjoyed the discussion, set. If you have really enjoyed the discussion, don't forget to click like, share, subscribe to our YouTube channel. The next class, we shall see the direct tension test on the mild shell rod, wherein we will find out the modulus of elasticity on the universal testing machine, right? Till then, bye bye, students.